Hello, Camano Chapel family. Pastor Brett here. I'm in my home because of the new edict coming down from Governor Jay Inslee to stay home, stay healthy. I'm giving an update from my home. Pastor Chris will be giving his sermon from his home, and Josie and her family will be doing the worship from their homes. So, three different locations, one worship service. We hope you're safe. We hope you're healthy. We hope you're staying home and staying healthy. These are difficult times. There's no doubt about it. It's been a difficult week in many ways for me. I've been able to call quite a few of you and talk with you, and it's been great to talk with you on the phone. I appreciated you answering and being able to talk with me. But these last couple days have been difficult. Not difficult like many countries have difficult, but just difficult in not being able to have human interaction. You know, God created us for fellowship. Fellowship with Him and fellowship with each other. So it's been tough. And I bet it's been tough for you as well. I was reading in my devotions this week, and I came across a verse in John chapter 16, verse 33, and I want to read that for you this morning. It says, "I have told you these things so that in me, you may have peace. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." That's been my verse. I've been writing it. I've been rereading it. I've been trying to memorize it. And it's just been a huge source of comfort for me. There's a couple things in the passage that stick out to me is that Jesus is our source of peace, but He's also saying you are going to have trouble, but I've overcome the world. And so I hope maybe that you'll look that up and maybe you can memorize that and write that during these difficult times. This is the last Sunday in the book of Daniel. Pastor Chris is going to start a new series next week. But this week is Our Sovereign God in the book of Daniel. This is the third week we've been on that. Also want to give you an update about His Pantry and our drop-off on Friday from 1 to 3 p.m. We were completely blown away at your faithfulness in giving. As always, Camano Chapel rises to the occasion. On an average month, we get about 600 pounds of food from the church. In a two-hour drop-off period, we got over 2,100 pounds. So thank you for your faithfulness in giving during this difficult time. Many families tomorrow are going to be affected because of your generosity and faithfulness. James 2:17, "In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." Your faith has been shown to be accompanied by action. So thank you for that. So let's sit back. Let's worship together. If you're with your family, please sing along. If you're by yourself, sing as loud as you can. Praise God with your voice as Josie and her family lead us in worship, and then Pastor Chris comes and gives us a message from Daniel. Again, I hope you are doing well. God bless, and I can't wait to get to see you in the not-so-distant future. Take care.
Welcome to our living room. We're so glad to have you join us in our home. Georgia and I are joined here by our future son-in-law, Bo. We're glad to have him on bass, and he's also helped us set up our technical equipment. And then we have our daughter, Mackenzie, who's behind the camera, helping to run the lyrics so that you can sing along with us this time. We are not going to let a little quarantine stop our praise from happening. So we are so thankful to be in a time and an age where technology allows us to still join together. So I hope that you'll get relaxed in your living rooms and that you'll lift your voices in song with us as we praise Him this morning.
I will look to you alone. God, my rock, God, my rock, God. are faithful through it all. God, my rock, God, my rock, God, my rock, in the blessing, the pain. Through it all, you never failed me, and you are the strength of my heart. Oh, you are the strength of my heart. I can rely on you. I can rely on you. When I struggle to believe, you have not let go of me. God, my rock, God, my rock. Carry through the darkest storm. You have held me in your arms. God, my rock, God, my rock, God, my rock. In the depths of the pain. Through it all, you never left me. And you are the strength of my heart. Oh, you are the strength of my heart. I can rely on you.
Jesus, thank you that we can trust in you when things don't make sense, when we don't know what tomorrow is going to hold, we still trust in you. Thank you, God, that you are strong enough to handle whatever is happening and nothing takes you by surprise. Lord, I pray that you would help use this morning to re-encourage us to bring our focus back on you. May you be the vision of our day. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Be thou my vision. tended my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of His glorious blood. My sin, not in gold, but the whole. His name to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that we can sing that together and we can pray that together, that it is well with our soul as we trust in you today and in the days ahead. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I want to give you an opportunity to spend just a couple minutes in guided prayer as part of our worship time together. And we were talking about it and how important it is for us to be regularly praying, and we can all do that on our own during the week, but joining together is what God calls us to do. And we might be not all be in literally the same room praying together, but God is not bound by the walls, so we are actively all praying together at this time. So I'm just going to lead you through just a couple things, and I know this might feel a little awkward in your little living rooms. If you're by yourself, great. You could even pray out loud. If you, if you're with your families or one other, I would love it if you prayed out loud, and I'm just going to give you a little time, and I'm going to ask that you would cover a couple of these specific things in prayer right now as a church family. So let's go before the Lord, and the first thing that I'm going to ask you to pray for is a prayer of covering, of protection, and of energy and strength and stamina and encouragement for our doctors and our nurses and healthcare providers that are working 24 hours a day in this crisis. Would you just pray a covering over them right now? now would you spend a few minutes and let's cover the scientists and the doctors that are working hard to find a vaccine that will help us. Would you pray that God would give them wisdom and knowledge to help science, to help them find that? And now would you pray for healing, for protection, for a halt to this virus? Lord, we need a miracle. Bring us a miracle, Lord. Would you pray over that? And last, would you now pray that God would work in us, in our hearts, in your heart, in my heart, that we would bring glory to God in this situation, that we wouldn't miss opportunities to share the hope that we have with a world that so desperately needs that hope. You're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop.
you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Hi, church family. We're back here in our living room at the Kramer household. And you can see, if you watched the midweek family gathering, that this video is a lot less beautiful. And the reason is Joyce isn't sitting next to me, so you're going to have to settle for this old bald guy bringing you the word today. But it's great to have you here. I hope you're doing well. I know many of you are, and I guess all of us are at home except for essential services. Pray that you're growing in the Lord and that you're spending some time in the Word each day. Maybe you have some more time now and you're maybe developing a good habit of Word and prayer each morning. So great to have you with us. Open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 4. You may want to pause the video at this point. Get your Bible so we can study along together. We're continuing in Daniel chapter 4. This is our last sermon in our series, Our Sovereign God. We've been talking about the sovereignty of God over all events and all people at all time, that the counsel of his will is irresistible and unstoppable. It's not just the sovereign God, but if you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you've trusted alone in him, you've called on his name, it's our sovereign God, it's your sovereign God, my sovereign God. And that's a great encouragement to us. Looking back over the series in part one, we talked about the frailty of man and the strength of God. In our text, Nebuchadnezzar, great king of Babylon, he falls from a great height to 7 years of mental illness, and he's out in the field like an animal. And then he turns his eyes to heaven. His reason is restored, and he praises God and begins to exalt the Most High. So here we see the frailty of Nebuchadnezzar and his strength came from God. Same with you and I. We're frail and we need Jesus every single day, not just for forgiveness from the penalty of our sins, but for everything in our lives. And then part two, that was last week, I discussed confidence in God's position and dominion. His position is the Most High, and we don't want to try to usurp God. Satan tried that, Lucifer. And we can see what was the result of that terrible mistake that he made in his rebellion. And then God's dominion. It's an everlasting dominion. It's predictable. You can count on it in unpredictable times. Well, today I want to talk about the smallness of man and the bigness of God. This is from verse 35. So again, this week, we're just going to study one verse, Daniel 4. 35, that says, and this, by the way, Daniel, in the book of Daniel here, it's King Nebuchadnezzar speaking, and he writes this, all the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing. And he, that's God, does according to his will among the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? Let's open with prayer and then we'll get into our study. Father God, as we study you today, I pray that we would come into perspective again of our great need for you, our smallness, your bigness, and Lord, that we would find great comfort in this. And courage as well, knowing that Though you are so high and lifted up, you also dwell within us through faith in Christ. You're our helper in times of need. Thank you, Father. Teach us now in Jesus' name. Amen. What we're going to see in our study today is there is this great comfort for the believer who understands the infinite gap between humanity and God Most High. I mean, the infinite. It can't be measured. Now, secular society despises the gap between humans and God. They, in fact, want to lift themselves up. There's a desire to be our own gods, and it's an idolatry, and it's an idolatry worshiping humanity, worshiping ourselves. We have really been fed this high view of humanity over a number of decades, and really what we have seen in the last couple, maybe three decades, is the high self-esteem movement that I am like a god. Included in that, that's been around for some time, is the power of positive thinking. And you may have heard the concept, the law of attraction. This is part of this view of a high view of human beings. The law of attraction is that if I give positive thoughts and I send it out into the universe, positive thoughts about my preferred future, that there is an attraction of good things and a positive future, that those thoughts draw them in, attraction, like a magnet. On the contrary, if I have pessimistic thoughts, then my thoughts actually have the power to repel a good future for me. This is the sense of humans having the ability to manufacture our future. And that is not what God has given us as humans. Only God can do that. He alone can set the course of the future. We can't think it into reality. And what I believe we're seeing right now with this virus is there is a crumbling of this sense of high self-worth. There is a crumbling that I can make a preferred future be attracted to me by my thoughts. People are afraid. They're anxious. In fact, I read a survey that was in an article. This survey was taken from March 16th to March 18th. 12,000 people were surveyed, and 92% of them said right now they're feeling anxious. Nearly a third of the people said that their anxiety had extremely impacted their daily life. They were gripped with anxiety. And from that survey, we learned that the anxieties stem from first economic concerns, then second job loss, third worry about loved ones, again, also fear for their own safety, and uncertainty about what happens next. So there's this vulnerability in our culture, which, by the way, Christian, gives us an opportunity to share our confidence in Christ over the phone or in an email or on Facebook. Let people know that there is hope and confidence can come from Christ. In fact, Los Angeles-based psychologist Liz Gustafson said this about what's happening right now. I've been finding that people are having past experiences of feeling helpless, feeling alone, feeling unprotected by authority figures, triggered by the current circumstances. Traumas related to previous illnesses or losses are being stirred up. And so people are crumbling with their anxiety, and their high view of themselves are crumbling along with it. So in the midst of this virus, God wants us to change our view about ourselves and change our view about Him. Just like Nebuchadnezzar, from 7 years of insanity, to lifting his eyes to heaven. That's what God wants for every single one of us. He wants us to learn, like Nebuchadnezzar, how small we are and how big he is. And my prayer, like Nebuchadnezzar came to this awareness, my prayer is that we will also come to see this in a more clear way in our lives. So let's take a look at the first part of verse 35, the smallness of man. Nebuchadnezzar says, all the inhabitants of the earth, so all of us, are accounted as nothing. Now, this does not mean that as human beings, we have no value. We're created in the image of God. Our value comes from God in the fact that he created us. It doesn't mean that we are absolutely worthless. It means that in comparison to God, that we are nothing. That God is so high and lifted up, we are absolutely nothing. And notice all the inhabitants of the earth. In Western culture, politicians have more power, or people that are wealthy, celebrities. We oftentimes put them on a different level. But with God, all are as nothing compared to his great and holy character and his great power. In Isaiah 40, in verse 15 and 17, this prophet writes, behold, the nations are like a drop from a bucket, a little drop of water. And these nations are accounted as the dust on the scales, the market scale, just a piece of dust. And then verse 17, all the nations are as nothing before God. They are accounted by him as less than nothing and emptiness. Christian, Camano Chapel family, there is truly an infinite gap between ourselves and God. We are very small. I think it's a great foolishness to raise ourselves up to God's level. There are two results of this. First is a false ego. We are not high and lifted up. We are low and needy. But if we try to convince ourselves that we are something great, that we are as God, we have a false ego. Secondly, what happens when we try to raise ourselves up to a high level is we recognize our failures. Either we try to cover those failures up or blame someone else because we want to stay up on that high pedestal in our own mind, or we come to realize, and this is good, that we realize we haven't only committed failures, but we are failures by nature. We are sinners by nature. And this, of course, leads to faith in Christ. We've got to realize that we are failures, we are sinners by nature before we can understand we need a Savior. I read an article by Mark Laberton. The article was written Between Failure and Fraud. Mark Laberton is a Christian writer, and I thought this was really good, kind of a metaphor for who we are without Christ. I'll just read part of this article. He says, in a very difficult season when finances were tight, I was driving a dilapidated car. It had lots of problems, including a ceiling lining that drooped down and grazed my head every time the broken shock absorbers launched me from the seat towards the roof. The car began to speak to me. It said, failure. Why couldn't I get my life together? I was getting older every year. I had a family, and this car was humiliating, and I felt like a failure. And then he writes about how two of his nieces came to visit him, and he thought, I don't want to drive them around showing them the sights of our town in this embarrassing car that will just tell them I'm a failure. So he leased a brand new car. And he said this, that day, still without the funds to buy a second car, I leased a new car. It was wonderful. No flakes, no droopy ceiling lining, no broken shocks. I was thrilled until the day this car also began to talk to me. Its message was also just one word. Fraud. I was no more put together, no more successful with this new car than the scuzzy borrowed one. It just looked better. And I was a fake. When we try to raise ourselves up, we hear that word. We're a failure because we are. We're failures in need of a savior. And if we try then to put on an image to our neighbors, to people we work with, to our friends, to people at church, that word speaks to us, fraud. You're not only a failure, now you're phony. You're a fraud. And so it's good for us to come to that place where we understand we're very small and acknowledge that. Maybe today, maybe during this sermon is an opportunity to say, God, I really thought I was very successful. I thought that I was better than most people morally. But Lord, I just want to acknowledge today that I am very small and I need you every single moment of my life. Well, the second part of verse 35 talks about the bigness of God. He, God, does according to his will among the host of heaven. The host of heavens generally is viewed as the angels. So he does his will among the inhabitants of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. He is Lord of both heaven and earth. No one can stay his hand. That word, that concept of staying his hand is strike his hand like we would a child reaching for a hot stove, slapping that child's hand. No one can hold back his hand. He is irresistible in his will, and we cannot in any way hinder what he's doing in the world today. We can't stay his hand. And no one can say to him, what have you done? Now, that's not asking God when we're hurting, God, what are you doing right now? Because when you read the Psalms, it talks a lot about how, you know, we can question God, that we can lament to God. But this is talking about being God's judge by saying, Father God, what are you doing? I know what's right. You don't know what's right. And this is harmful for our spiritual health. So here's another danger. That's bringing God down to our level. It's dangerous in our smallness to try to raise ourselves up to God's level, but to try to bring him down. Several years ago, some of you here at the church, you went on a tour that I hosted to Greece and to Ephesus in Turkey, and then we spent a couple of days in Rome. And one of the things we did while we were there was to go through the Vatican. Incredible tour. And the very end of the tour, kind of the grand finale, is entering into the Sistine Chapel, which is the personal chapel of the Pope. And all of Michelangelo's paintings. And on the ceiling, I think the most famous is the Creation of Adam. And you see him reaching towards God, and God is connecting with him and creating him. And Adam is this very, young, powerful man. And then you see God leaning over, and he's partly unclothed. He's in the image of a man, which is a graven image. God is a spirit, and no one should ever attempt to make a likeness of God, but he's reaching over and he's got a long, long gray hair, a long straggly beard. And I remember in the Sistine Chapel, and I've thought about it since then, that God there was brought down to a human level. This old man, a man that looked like he was aging, like today, maybe is in that very vulnerable population to the coronavirus. He was brought down. I don't think that was the purpose or the motive, but certainly really showed God in a false way and bringing him down on a human level, and this is not good. Someone has written this: corrupt and sinful man has made God too much in his own image. Man has lowered God, as all idolatry does, thinking of him as if he were but a creature. We've heard of or seen pendulums that swing back and forth, and sometimes that can happen in our thoughts. And for many years, the transcendence of God alone was emphasized, that he's high and holy, and people began to see him as very, very distant and maybe even uncaring. And it swung over to the immanence of God, which is also true, but without the transcendence of God, there's imbalance. Of course, without the immanence of God, there's imbalance. But the pendulum seems to have swung over to the immanence of God, the closeness of God. And there's a sense that has come along with that swing to an irreverence towards God. Maybe we've seen, you know, bumper stickers or people saying, God's my buddy, or he's my co-pilot, or God is my homeboy, or the man upstairs, bringing God down. As a result, our view of God starts diminishing, and we find no comfort from God. We lose the gift of comfort when we bring God down. Let me read you some common statements, and then I'm going to identify what doctrine of God has been diminished. Here's a statement, and a couple of these, I have to admit, I've had these in my life where I've thought these. Maybe you will agree with me and say, you know what? I've had those thoughts, but here's one. God is trying to do the best he can, but he must be unable to understand how much this situation hurts me. That's diminishing the wisdom and knowledge of God. Here's another statement. If God would just change his mind, he would relieve me of the suffering instead of letting it take its course. That's diminishing the doctrine of the immutability of God. Immutability of God is that he's changeless, that he is who he is, and he doesn't waffle. He doesn't slide back and forth to popular opinion. Another one. God isn't in complete control, or he would change the situation so that I could be relieved of my pain. That's diminishing the sovereignty of God, of which we've been talking about. And finally, God is fickle in his compassion towards people. Otherwise, he would not allow me to go through this. And that's diminishing the love of God. I want a God that's infinitely higher than myself. I don't want a God that's like me. In fact, that thought terrifies me. Does it to you as well? Think of yourself as a private in the military, and you're in Afghanistan, and you're facing your first battle. And there you are, scared, looking for guidance, looking for your authority to take charge. And there you look to the sergeant in your platoon, and he's just scared, he's shaking, he's trying to load his gun, he can't remember, and he's looking around with uncertainty. He even turns to you and says, do you have any ideas of what we should do? That's terrifying. I don't want that kind of God, and that is not the one true God. That is not the God revealed in the Bible. Fortunately, the God of the Bible is in complete control over all events and all people, whether it's directly or indirectly. So what are you facing right now that is causing you anxiety and discomfort? Could it be that maybe you're trying to take on a burden that God wants to carry? As I've oftentimes said, we live a lot of our lives pushing buttons, pulling levers, spinning dials to control our lives. And when we feel anxiety, or we feel things are not under control, things feel like they're spinning out of control globally, what happens? Our desire to control oftentimes goes up. And God all along says, hey, I care for you, so you can cast your cares on me. I think on this Sunday morning, or whenever you're viewing this video, what an opportunity to return to that awareness that I'm really small. I'm really little. God is big. God is great. And he indwells me. And nothing can separate me from his love, his compassion, and the strength he wants to give us through his Holy Spirit. Let me close with a verse that's really a very high and holy prayer. It comes from Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 6. You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens, and all their starry host. The earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you. Now that's a really, really big God. And that big God loves you so much that he gave his one only son, Jesus, to die on the cross for your sins. How much more, through the life of Christ, will he protect you? Will he be your refuge, your strength, your strong tower? It's all found in Christ alone. Let's pray. Father God, we look to you as the giver of all good things. We acknowledge to you right now that we are very small. We are a frail, needy, and vulnerable people. But Lord, our eyes look to you. They look to your throne, your bigness, your greatness, your majesty. And Lord, that you are for us, not against us. God, we are rest in you, and we cast all our cares upon you, for we know that you care for us. Father, today, if we don't know your son, Jesus, we can cast our care upon him, our cares that we are sinners by nature and we need a savior. And we can cast our sins upon Christ on the cross, and we receive his perfection. And therefore, we are in a right relationship with you. I pray for those watching this video that need a savior, that have not yet trusted, that today would be the day of saying, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Give me your perfection. I trust fully in you and your substitute on the cross. And I give you my life, and I repent of my sins. Jesus' great name. Amen. As always, be sure and share this video. If you trusted Christ today, can you go on CaminoChapel.org website? There's a place to put a prayer request. Let us know that you've trusted Christ. We'd like to be praying for you. Maybe you have rededicated your life. You can do the same thing. We want to hear from you, and we want to serve you. We want to pray for you. God bless you.
I know to you.
week together, and we'll see you back here Wednesday night. God bless you.
So this world has lost its grip on me.